Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this PestFacts WA webinar. My name is Sydney Webster, and I am the PestFacts newsletter editor and project lead, and I am hosting the webinar today. This webinar has been funded by the Department of Primary Industries and Regional Development and GRDC as part of the RPM for Grains project. And moving on to today's agenda, we have DPIRD Senior Research Scientist Ian Foster talking about WA's climate outlook for 2023. We then have Svetlana Micic discussing what pests growers need to watch out for this season. We will be having a question and answer session at the very end of the webinar, so please use the Q&A tool or the chat function to ask any questions or make any comments that you'd like to discuss with our presenters. We will be keeping all attendees muted just to keep the sound quality going well during the webinar, but we'll be making the webinar recording and the PowerPoint slides available after this webinar today. And I will now hand over to Ian to start his presentation. Thank you, Ian.
Okay, thanks, Cindy, and welcome all. The outline will be pretty simple. I'll just start off with a recap of what was happening last year, summer rain and also autumn, what was different last year, and then roll into the outlooks for autumn this year and looking into early winter and why it looks quite a bit different from it was last year. And finally, with a bit of a view of how you can now get monthly and downscaled outlooks from the Bureau of Nets website. So this year's summer is very similar to last year's summer in terms of being fairly dry. So these two maps are from the Bureau of Met. They're showing the rainfall deciles for the 3 months to February in last year, which is a chart on the left, and this year chart on the right. Colour coding is anywhere that is red was well below average for that period. Anywhere was white was about average, and anywhere was blue was above average. So last year's summer and this year's summer was similar for the grain belt from the point of view that it wasn't very, you know, that there wasn't a lot of rain. So this year and last year at the start of March, we're rolling into a similar sort of a pattern. Now, one of the things that happened last year was that there were rain events in late March for the northern grain belt and also then in April for the south. So the chart on the left just shows the national rainfall deciles for March to May, same sort of colour coding as before, where it was above average for a lot of the agricultural area, but below average for the lower southwest. Out of interest, I'm showing also the Bureau of Meteorology's outlook for late February, looking at the chance of exceeding median rain from March to May. So the colour coding there, that greeny blue colour, it was more likely to be wetter than average, or at least that was what the model was indicating, especially for eastern Australia, but also over a lot of inland WA. So you can see with the map on left of what actually happened, it didn't get the Northern Territory right, but that was a traditionally period of very little rain anyway. So it expected eastern Australia to be wet, and that happened. A lot of inland WA was wetter, and also intriguingly there was also the piece on the south coast the model thought might get wetter, and it did indeed. So broadly the way that autumn turned out last year was quite consistent in general with what the model was expecting. This is the Bureau of Meteorology's access model. Out of interest, looking at what happened, say the period we're looking at now, April to June 2022, the map on the left is just the outcome, where that actually was a generally drier period. So that sort of early to middle part of the growing season is actually drier, apart from the south coast. And that on the chart on the right is a Bureau of Meteorology's outlook. Again, they expected eastern Australia to be wet, and that broadly came to pass. The projections for the Northern Territory are often quite variable because it almost never rains at that time anyway. But it was also expecting the large areas of inland WA potentially to be wetter, and that came to pass. But interestingly, it also had a dry period for the southwest corner, which did come to pass. So the model, apart from some geographical variations, actually wasn't necessarily completely wrong. One of the things that made a big difference last year was the way the spring turned out anyway. So the outlook was expecting the start of the season after the good autumn rain to maybe be a little bit light on for rain, and that was what transpired. So it's out of interest that last year's period sort of came out pretty much according to what was expected. Now, over the weekend, this is the March rain to date, there had been a series of very severe thunderstorms throughout the grain belt. In some places, more than 50 millimetres, highly patchy. So the chart on the left just shows the total rain to date, some areas exceeding 50 millimetres already for the month, and other areas not too much. So the area northeast of Geraldton, for example, is around Una. They've got some big storms yesterday. The chart on the right just shows the deviation from average in terms of the rainfall anomalies. So you can see for a lot of the grain belt, especially the eastern grain belt and bits of the north, it's already wetter than average for March. So depending upon how that rain arrived, it may or may not be useful for soil moisture. Given it was from fairly intense thunderstorms, I wouldn't mind betting a fair bit of that has actually run off as opposed to soaked into the soil. Rolling into the outlook for this year, there's lots of brown. These sets of charts from the Bureau of Meteorology's access model. The top left is where you can now look at month by month by itself. So that's for April. Then May is the top right, then April, May, June, the bottom left, and then May, June, July. So this was from the runs done last week from the Bureau's model. They'll update it this Thursday. The colour coding, as you're probably familiar with, just shows the chance of exceeding median for that period of time. And so the brown colours tells you you're less than 40%, maybe around 33% chance of exceeding median. So that tells you it's about twice as likely to be drier than average than it is above average. So it's possible, but the odds are pointed against it. Things to note, I guess, are the geographical consistency. That is, it's most of the continent is expecting the same sort of outcome. And it persists for 3 months, April, May, June, and also rolling into May, June, July. So the pattern is very spatially coherent, and it also persists through time as well. But the Bureau of Met is not the only system you can look at. This next slide shows a sample from some international systems. The first three charts there are from a European site, which in itself is a multi-model ensemble of 8 models. Expressed in the same way as chances of exceeding median, slightly different colour scheme, so it might not look quite as scary as the Bureau of Met's one, but the same sorts of probabilities, less than a 40% chance of exceeding median for April, May, June on the top left, May, June, July. They have a look then at the traditional winter of June, July, August on the bottom left. And then the chart on the bottom right is from a Korean system, the APEC multi-model ensemble. Slightly different way of doing it. They've used different colours where they just show the preference for either below normal, normal or above normal. And so I just put that in there because interestingly, they're looking at late winter and early September, a fair old lead time to that. So the confidence may be a little bit lower, but it's interesting that the dynamical models are expecting this pattern to continue pretty much right through winter into early spring. Now, as well as just a chance of being below, above or median, you can also get information of how far above or below the model might be expecting. And this is an example from the Bureau of Met's website, where you can pick rainfall extremes. And in this case, what they mean by the lowest or the extreme dry is the lowest 20% of rainfall for that period. And so what I've selected is April to June, and the color coding there is just shows the relativity in terms of the long-term chances. So it's saying that the chances of rainfall April to June being in the lowest 20% are about twice as high as normal, as long-term climate. So not only is it saying it's more likely to be drier than normal, it's more likely to be quite a bit drier than normal. The chart on the right shows their historical predictive skill as expressed as accuracy or hit rates. You can see there it is doing better than 55% for that hindcast set of years of 81 to 2018. So it's not a hugely strong skill, but it is certainly better than guessing. So it's up to you with your attitude to risk of whether you think that type of display is reliable enough. So the models do seem to be having a little bit of skill at this sort of thing. So anyway, the Bureau of Met's model is expecting it to be actually quite a bit drier. You could also have a look now at rainfall outlooks for individual locations, because those map type displays are all very well, but you might want to see what happens in your part of the world. An example I've got here is for Dawalinu, largely because I was there last week. So you can either pick a point on the map or use the little name selector and it pulls a pin up, but then it brings up a pop-up which I've enlarged here, where you can look at the rainfall outlook in a range of different ways. These links up at the top there are active. You can look at the next 4 weeks or in the bit that I selected the next 5 months. And it shows you the rain to date. So the solid line is the observations. And then these box and whisker plots are the sets, the distribution of runs from the access model. So again, that the top one is the 90th percentile, and the box itself is between the 25th and 75th percentile, with the median as a line in the middle. You're probably familiar with this sort of thing. Anyway, the dotted line is where they've simply connected up the median of all the runs. So according to this, the model's expected for each of these 3 months to sort of be bumping along around decile 3 and 4. There's a chance these periods could be wetter than average, but the chances are not as high. And at the top there, you see the little star ratings is the predictive skill for that period. So the more stars, the better. So 2 stars is not too bad for March and April. And this is from runs done in March, but then lower skill for June and July. So there's only 1 star. But however, it shows a consistent pattern in that it gets wetter climatologically in May, June and July. So that's good. However, it still implies that the preference of the model runs, or the middle bit of that, is more likely to, you know, struggle to exceed that average. So it's still sort of implying, at even downscale to a place like Dalwalnyu, that it's likely to be a bit scratchy for rainfall. You can also have a look at the thing in the modelling systems by getting some idea of why this might be going on. And these two charts here are mean sea level pressure differences for April, May, June, and May, June, July, forecast from the Bureau's Access Gene model. So this is a global chart. It just shows a deviation from average where the colour coding, if it's that pinky colour, it says the model is expecting pressures to be higher than average. If it's bluer than, if it's bluey colour, expects the pressure to be lower than average. And your eye is immediately drawn to the large expanse of high pressure to the South Australia and also in the South Pacific. And that, if anything, as they roll into May, June, July, tends to become stronger. And also the difference between our types of latitudes and Antarctica. So that particular pattern looks very much what's known as a positive southern annular mode, where the cold fronts are there, but they tend to be either weaker or a bit further to the south. And the high pressure systems are just more prominent. Now, it doesn't mean there's always going to be high pressure. There will be weather systems coming through, but the odds are that once it goes through, it'll be replaced by another high pressure system. So for our part of the world, that seems to be the physical driver behind the consistency of the below normal rainfall for the Australian region. And the other international models, which I haven't shown, give you the same sort of pattern. The other thing to note across the Pacific Ocean, there is a hint of the expected El Nino event, which will give you lower pressures there. And also the difference between here and here is the Southern Oscillation. So there's a degree of dynamical consistency with all of this stuff. I mentioned El Nino, and these are a couple of charts from the Bureau of Meteorology where they're looking at predictions of, on the left-hand chart, the likelihood of an El Nino event. And in this particular display, they're looking at sea surface temperatures in a particular box called the Nino 3.4 region in the eastern Pacific. If that sea surface temperature is consistently above, say, 0.8 of a degree, it's considered to be consistent with El Nino. Most of the models are getting to that threshold by July. The Bureau of Mets is by far the most enthusiastic about this, but the others are all doing something similar. Last year, we had a La Nina, so those bars are all pointing to the left into the blue region. So that seems to be reasonably solid. The models are all expecting this to happen, even though it's pretty early in the season for them to kick off. But anyway, they're pretty consistent about it. The other chart is the Indian Ocean Dipole. Now, that doesn't usually kick off till really late winter or spring. And that's a similar sort of a phenomenon in the Indian Ocean. Again, swings between positive and sort of negative phases. In this case, this is an index number. The models, interestingly, are expecting a positive IOD happening. Now, there's much less confidence with this because it's a smaller phenomenon, doesn't quite have the momentum and the grunt behind it that El Nino will have. However, it's interesting to note at this stage, at least, the models are thinking, well, yeah, this might be happening as well. So we shall see how they evolve. If you get the two things happening together, that does act to suppress national rainfall. And the chart on the left is the canonical pattern of seven years when you've had a positive IOD and an El Nino occurring at the one time. So that was 1963, 72, 82, 94, 97, 2006, and 2015, which is the most recent time it's happened. And the chart on the right is one that Meredith has generated. We looked at the May to October rainfall, looked at the deciles. So again, the canonical pattern expects southwest is likely to have suppressed rainfall, and that came to pass. Less of an influence in the far northeastern grain belt. And as it turns out, an example of 2015, they actually had average to slightly wetter. So it doesn't mean it's drought and disaster everywhere, but it does have the effect where the two things are working together, that they do have a stronger combined effect. So that's yet another thing that, that maybe adds a bit of weight to the projections of the dry conditions to continue through. So the take-home message, I guess, is hardly surprising. In a summer rain was similar to last year. The big difference is that the autumn rain outlook is much drier than it was last year. And this rolls through into winter as well. You can now get weekly, monthly outlooks, and so you can drill down to smaller time periods and smaller locations now. And as far as those large sort of climate drivers, an El Nino does seem likely. It's starting to shape up like that already, with maybe an IOD event to note as well. So should those things come to pass, then that will probably just reinforce this relatively poor start. So it doesn't mean that there'll be no rain. Like we've seen, there's been, you know, thunderstorms already, but it's quite likely to mean that spatially it's going to be patchy and there may be big gaps between the rain events. So it's just a bit of a heads up that this year's shaping up to be quite different from last year.
So from what everything you've said, I expect that we're looking for a drier than average start to this season. And what does it really mean for our fly-in, fly-out pests, our FIFO pests, and also for the resident pests, those pests that are present in our systems year in, year out? Well, it is one of these things where we have been looking at the green bridge that's been present throughout the landscape. So the maps that you can see on the left and the right show the rainfall from January to March. So the darker the colour, the less rainfall there is. So the reddy colours, less rainfall, up to the blue where there has been rainfall. And you can see that throughout most of our broadacre growing areas, it's been quite dry. But we've just finished last week a survey looking at the green bridge. And there is a bit of a green bridge, mainly consisting of grasses, which are the green circles. Or if there's been a brassica found in the green bridge, it's a yellow in a green circle. So mainly around the south, we do have brassicas and grassy weeds. We've also found in those green bridges diamondback moth, but mainly in the southern parts of the state. And what this does mean is that even though we've found diamondback moth on these green bridges, in previous years where we have put a trap in a canola paddock that's been near one of these traps. So in 2022, you can see the map here on the left-hand side. You can see these green circles with a yellow dot inside. That's where we had the traps. Adjacent to these green circles, we monitored canola paddocks. And what we found was that you do get an early occurrence of diamondback moth in areas where you have radish, and you can see that from the map on the right hand side where we have the large circles with a number associated with them. We did find diamondback moth. It really is the conditions in the paddock as to whether or not the diamondback moth actually took off. Last year we found that the diamondback moth only occurred at levels that required control only in four paddocks throughout our broadacre growing areas where we were monitoring for diamondback moth. But if we do have a drier start to the season, just bear in mind that diamondback moth are resistant to many insecticides and their life cycle can be as short as 15 days, depending on what the temperatures are like. So do bear that in mind if we are having any brassica weeds adjacent to canola paddocks especially. But keep a lookout on PestFacts because the diamondback moth project is again occurring this year and we will be reporting what we're finding in traps. Another one where under normal circumstances, I wouldn't be talking about aphids because with such a dry season, our aphid numbers tend to be quite low across the broadacre growing regions. But Russian wheat aphid, which was first detected in 2020, what we found was in 2022, you can see this is a map from PestFacts, In 2021, we had a wet start to the season and we found Russian weed aphid had spread basically from Esperance all the way through Perth and throughout our grain growing regions. In 2022, I was expecting to have very few reports. Instead, we found Russian weed aphid all the way out at Geraldton. This aphid has a very wide host range with grasses, so anywhere that we've had grasses surviving our hot, dry summer, we can expect the aphid to be present. Its movement into cropped paddocks will really depend on what the seed dressings are that have been applied and whether or not there's a green bridge in association to that paddock. But I'd just like to remind everyone that we have been looking at the Russian weed aphid intervention calculator that is available on the GRDC website. And what we looked at was the modelling behind this calculator to determine that determines whether or not there's going to be yield loss from the aphid. Now, on the calculator, you must input your cost of control, your expected market price, your yield potential, and the important one is how long it is until head emergence. And this is your best guess because the longer the aphid is present on the plant for, the more yield loss there is. And then you also need to input the number of observed tillers with Russian weed aphid. And if you then look, it puts out a little graph. It'll tell you in the circle where what your action threshold is, so what you when you need to spray. It also predicts a square as to if you do nothing, what the predicted yield loss will be. And we ran a series of four trials and pretty much found that the model is consistent with the yield loss we got in our trials. But you really need to look at aphid numbers per tiller and not look at feeding damage as an indicator of Russian weed aphids, because the feeding damage symptoms, which is that purpling and striping on the leaves, is not an indicator of Russian weed aphid. And under normal circumstances, we'd walk away, but I need to remind you all, the green peach aphid is one that does thrive when we have a warmer than average start to the season. And we really need you to be able to identify aphid species. So the DPIRD website, as does the GRDC website, has a plethora of information on aphid identification. We do have some new aphid species only in the eastern states at this time, but please, if you see anything unusual on any crops, please identify it. And remember that green peach aphid is very tolerant and resistant to many insecticides. So please get your identifications right before spraying. We also do expect that if there's an early influx of aphids, that we will get earlier activity of predators of aphids. So do also bear in mind what sprays you're applying. And the fly in, fly out pests, look, they're really only the aphids and our caterpillar and moths that fly in that we're expecting to have an issue with. But it's really only in the areas where we do have a green bridge. However, with a warmer than expected start to the season, we do get unusual pests turning up. So please, if you see anything unusual, report it through the PestFacts reporter app. What we also expect to have this year, even though it's expected to be dry in parts, we are expecting red-legged earth mites to start hatching. Bear in mind that we do have a number of populations of red-legged earth mites which are resistant to many insecticides. There is a red-legged earth mite hatch model available, which is available at this website here at CSER Australia. If you do go on there, you can type in your postcode and it will tell you when it's expected to hatch. So these are the expected hatching dates for Albany through to Dandaragon. And so really we are expecting hatching to occurring in the lower parts of the state as of this week and all the way into April and May. If you find red-legged earth mites in higher numbers than what you anticipate, please contact us. These are the resistant results from 2022. We had over 67% of the populations we tested were either resistant to synthetic pyrethroids or organophosphates or both. So this map is showing where we found resistance to synthetic pyrethroids, again, mainly in the southern parts of the state, But we are finding that more and more properties are being found each year with synthetic pyrethroid resistance. But what we're finding is that each time we undertake testing, we find more populations which are resistant to synthetic pyrethroids as well as organophosphates. This is one of the last few years we will be undertaking resistance testing. So please contact the PestFacts team if you'd like your property tested. All of the properties where we have red-legged earth mites that are resistant to insecticides, the majority of times the insecticides were not applied for the control of red-legged earth mites. So if you do need to apply any control measures, please consider the pests that you are not targeting, so the ones that are going to get sprayed instead, and have a look at the red-legged earth mite resistance strategy available on the GRDC website. For those of you located mainly in the higher rainfall areas of the state, we do have a biological control agent that can be released for the control of red-legged earth mites. There is a catch. It's highly susceptible to synthetic pyrethroids and really only survives in areas where you can't spray. However, it is a possible control option for you, especially in areas of the paddocks where you regularly have incursions of red-legged earth mites. Please contact the PestFacts team if you're interested in collecting the French anistis mite. The other mite species that we have predominantly in our broadacre growing areas are Bryobia and Bolorsia mite. We usually only have them being an issue in years where we've had a green bridge. Even though this year we have not, drier starts to the season do sometimes mean that crops don't grow as well. So bear in mind that if you are growing canola, that Bryobia mite only affects canola, causing the white lines. If the true leaf of the canola has come out, assess the damage to the true leaf before you spray. Only spray if the crop is not outgrowing the damage. Brown wheat mite looks exactly like Bryobia mite, but it's only found on cereals. And we find that the bryobean mites, the Bryobia and the brown wheat mite, tend to really thrive in when we have these warmer than average starts to the season. Bolorsia mite, we tend to find is more of an issue when we have a green bridge, but it does thrive quite nicely on grasses. So just bear in mind that if they're present, spray only if you absolutely have to. Lucerne flea is one that each year we have people that get caught out because lucerne flea does not require a temperature requirement to hatch. Just a reminder that red-legged earth mites will only hatch after we've had 7 days of temperatures below 20 degrees and at least a 5 mil rain event. So lucerne flea, all they require is some rain, and that causes the clay coating on the outside of the eggs to break down and initiates hatching. They can be found throughout paddocks, and just bear in mind that just because you have the clay patches, if you have been claying or doing any other remedial works in paddocks and you traditionally have had you've traditionally had lucerne flea, they may also be moving into those clade paddocks. So that's just something to bear in mind. Another one that everybody keeps forgetting, because mollusks do require moisture to stay alive. Unfortunately, we have some very adept mollusks in our landscape which survive hot, dry summers. So we're expecting that again, the slugs to be an issue in the southern parts of the state. What we tend to find is that if we have had really good opening rains, the black keel slug will come out in force. And if you have dry sown, please monitor crops for at germination, because all you need is one black keel slug per square metre and you can have extensive damage occurring to your canola. One well-timed bait will control slug population. As soon as you see slugs out and about, they have a well-developed albumen gland, which every mollusk needs an albumen gland to produce eggs. And once you see the slugs, they're already out and about and ready to lay eggs. So that's something to bear in mind. We do anticipate that even if it is a drier start to the season and we do get moisture stress crops, it is the dew at night that keeps those slugs active. Now, for snails, we have round snails and small pointed snails down south as well as up in the northern parts of the state. They will all have survived a hot, dry summer. We have a webinar next week discussing more management techniques on snails, but you do really need to budget for more than one baiting event if you have small pointed. Round snails, look, a single bait, you'll get good control. Right now, I've undertaken some albumen gland dissections, and what we found is in the round snails collected from Mount Barker and the South Stirlings, these are actively feeding. The gland is starting to increase in size. It's not fully developed, so they haven't started to lay eggs yet. We expect egg lay to be occurring in the next fortnight. Round snails collected from Hopeton also had food in their guts. The albumen gland was not anywhere near being developed, but I anticipate that with the recent rain that's occurred, that we'll have the round snails also actively moving and actively feeding, so now would be a really good time to bait. But before I leave you all, I just want to make a little reminder about the weevils. Usually we have more weevils in association with crops where we've had a green bridge over summer, or last year you've had a weedy paddock. This year we are undertaking some surveys for Desiantha weevil, looking at its resistance profile to see whether or not some of the reports we've been getting from growers and agronomists that they are showing a higher tolerance to some of the insecticides. So we'll report our findings in PestFacts, but we would really like to hear from you if you have any paddocks with Desiantha weevil. And just a reminder that weevils in hot, dry conditions survive quite nicely, so do keep an eye out for them, and they can be quite cryptic and quite difficult to find. If we have temperatures above 18 degrees, mainly in the lower parts of the state, we do have issues with vegetable beetle. Vegetable beetle are very difficult to control. Control measures are quite difficult to apply and to get a good kill. Please really make sure that you definitely have got vegetable beetle causing damage to the canola. They can cause ring barking to canola, as you can see here on the left. They can also feed on leaf tissue. So if you do have them causing damage, it really is if temperatures and daytime temperatures have been above 18 degrees. Only apply control measures if the crop is definitely not outgrowing the damage. And contact your PestFacts team for further advice or your local agronomist. European earwigs are another one in combination with slaters. Slaters will have survived a hot, dry summer if there's been cracking clays in the paddock. European earwigs are quite adept at surviving hot, dry summers. They don't really thrive when we have a wetter than average start to the season, but a drier than average start to the season, we tend to find that there's a lot of eggs that survive when they lay eggs and produce twice a year, so during summer and in winter, and we tend to find that there's a lot more survival when we have a drier winter for those eggs, and we do tend to have an increase in populations then. But just a reminder for European earwigs and for slaters that there are baits registered that can be easily applied. And if you find absolutely anything out there that you don't know what it is or you'd like it identified, please contact the PestFacts team. We do rely on you to basically report anything that you're finding, and if you are finding something that is very unusual, take a photo and report it, and we can get back to you with an identification.
Thanks very much, Svetlana and Ian. We are now getting to the end of our webinar. We're slightly gone over time, but this is a great time if you do have any questions or comments that you'd like to give to our presenters while we have them live. And this is a reminder that the recording of this webinar will be put on the DPIRD YouTube channel, and we'll also be publishing the PowerPoint slides on our webpage. We will share that information when we have it. And we do have the presenter contact details on our screen. So if you do think of a great question afterwards, as does happen, feel free to contact them or the PestFacts email. We did have one question I have personally. It's probably more for Ian. Ian, if you wouldn't mind unmuting. How reliable are your climate forecasts? That's kind of a question that we do often get from growers when we say that there's an outlook, a drier than average outlook. So if you wouldn't mind answering that question.
Yep. Well, the answer depends. I suppose I'm not trying to be difficult. The further ahead the lead time is, usually the poorer the skill. So that's why if you've got a model, say, that's set up in March, April, May, June, it'll have higher skill than if you're looking at, say, June, July, August or beyond. So there's that bit of it. One thing that it does seem to be, and I've looked at the last few years or so, if they're all expecting the same sort of thing, that is like 2019, the consensus of the models was that the seasonal outlook, at each time they do the updates, was likely to be drier than average. That seemed to work. So the models, it may sound slightly strange, but they do seem to be better at predicting no rain or little rain than predicting rain. So the dry conditions the last few years, that in 2019, they actually were telling us what was going to happen, and it did. Last year, the outlooks were a bit more mixed. Some were wetter, some were, you know, some were neutral. But one of the things that was coming out of us, that the number of them that were expecting dry conditions was relatively low. Some of it got to be, you certainly got to look at several models and get the sense of what the ensembles are all saying is, you know, one thing. Yes. But in recent years, they've actually become reasonably reliable for predicting drier seasons. The other bit to bear in mind is that their technology has been changing over time. The model outlooks done, say, in 2012 or something, were not nearly as skillful as they are at the moment. So there have been advances in model tech, calculations, earth observing systems and all the rest. So they have been getting better. So this again will be another example, another test case, because they were so consistent expecting it to be drier. So we'll see at the end of the year, because that's the ultimate test, all right? They're just modeling systems. They've made the best estimates of what direction they think the climate system is going to go, but it's got to actually unfold to get the verification. So yes, they do actually seem to be a bit more reliable at predicting drier seasons.
I see. Thanks very much for answering that, Ian. And Svet, we look forward to seeing what you communicate via PestFacts and other communication channels in regards to pest activity this season and what we hear from the industry and what they're finding in the paddocks. And we have no other questions at this stage, so we'd like to conclude the webinar. I'd like to thank everyone who's taken the time to attend today. Thank you very much, Ian and Svetlana, for presenting, and Jeanette Pratt for co-hosting the webinar. And I would like to acknowledge the GIDC co-funded project IPM for Grains, who funded today's webinar. So we would like to finish the webinar here for today, but we do look forward to hearing any of your insect or plant disease reports that you have during the season. But for now, we'll say goodbye and we wish you a great rest of your day. Okay, thank you, everyone. Goodbye.